lectures. This is the third subunit of the first unit of grade 9 chemistry, composition of an atom and the isotopes. Now, we have to go through some key terms in order to understand much more about an atom. Our first key term is the atomic number. This might be the most important number in chemistry. We use it all the time in order to understand many chemistry concepts. The atomic number, which we represent with a Z or a Z, is the number of protons. Now, if the atom is stable, I'll explain what stable is in a bit. So if the atom is stable, the number of protons is usually the same as the number of electrons. I'm using shorthand for this. This is how you represent an electron, an E with a negative sign on top. So only if the atom is stable, or only if the atom is neutral. What I mean by that, think of stability as the electrons are calm and haven't gone anywhere, because electrons like to move around. They like to go from place to place to place. If the electrons are where they are or where they should be, the atom is stable, and the atomic number is the number of protons, which is also equal to the number of electrons. But usually we say the atomic number is the number of protons, because protons' number never change, while electrons' number may change. So atomic number is the number of protons. Next, we have mass number. Okay, mass number is represented by A, and it's the number of protons plus the number of neutrons. How you can remember which subatomic particles to add, just think of whatever is in the nucleus, okay? What are the subatomic particles in the nucleus? The protons and the neutrons. Therefore, mass number is simply the sum of the two. It's just a number. You just count how many particles there are in the nucleus, the sum of the protons and the neutrons. So we can say that mass number, A, is equal to the sum of the protons plus the neutrons. It's as simple as that. Now, while atomic number, I can write this here, is simply the number of protons. The next concepts are isotopes. Now, it says that isotopes are atoms with the same Z but different A. The same atomic number but different mass number. Now, how could this be? Look back to the formulas we just wrote. Atomic number is the number of protons, and mass number is the number of protons plus neutrons. If you have two atoms with the same atomic number, so technically, it's the same element, they have the same atomic number but different mass numbers. The only way that could be, if we look here, the only way that these two could be different is if you have a different number of neutrons. So for isotopes, you have the same number of protons, the same number of electrons, but different number of neutrons. That's the key thing to isotopes. This can happen. It's the same element. You still call it hydrogen or oxygen or whatever it may be, but they have a different neutron number, which makes them isotopes. Remember, this was the point, this was the discovery that contradicted Dalton's third point in the atomic theory. He said that all atoms of the same element have the same properties, but no. Atoms of the same element could have isotopes, meaning they have different mass numbers or different masses. Alright, so that is why isotopes brought us to have the new modern atomic theory that we have today. If you don't know what I'm talking about, check out my previous subunit about the atomic theories. Alright. Next, we have atomic mass. Now, there's two types of atomic masses. There's the relative atomic mass and the average atomic mass. The most common one we use is the relative atomic mass. Now, it's based on the weight of C12. C12 means carbon 12, all right? There's this standard weight that we use, carbon 12, and all other elements, the weight of all other elements, we use in reference to this carbon 12. Average atomic mass is based on isotopes, the concept that we just saw earlier. So depending on the weight of the isotopes, we then find an average to find the actual weight of the element. We'll see each of these in detail in a bit. First, isotopes. Okay, let's go through the examples of isotopes. Here we have three isotopes of hydrogen. Hydrogen 1, hydrogen 2, hydrogen 3. So, I forgot to mention earlier how you can write a shorthand for mass number and atomic number. It's like this. Hydrogen 1 means that the mass number is 1. And the symbol for hydrogen is H. So I'm going to write this for each, H, 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 right? And you always write the mass number on the top left side, all right? So right up here, I'll say for this, hydrogen 1, hydrogen 2, and hydrogen 3. For the atomic number of hydrogen is 1, so we write this at the bottom left corner, 1, 1, 1, okay? I'm sorry, I didn't mention this earlier. For any element, if you have X, any element X, you always write the mass number at the top, like this, and the atomic number at the bottom, like this. It's just shorthand in order to quickly understand or to quickly identify the mass number and atomic number of any element. So back to this example, we see we have three hydrogens, three isotopes of hydrogen. How are the isotopes? Simply put, they have the same atomic number, but they have different mass numbers. Now, how do we clearly show why these are isotopes? Why don't we graphically draw how these atoms would actually look like. Well, first let's draw what's in the nucleus, okay? We know that there's one proton, right? So there's one positive charged particle in the center of each of them, right? Because we know the atomic number is one, meaning that there's one proton in all the isotopes. Atomic numbers don't change, it's the mass number that changes. Now, we know that for the first isotope, we know that one being the mass number is the number of protons plus the number of neutrons. We already know that the one down here is the number of protons. That means the number of neutrons must be zero. Okay, I just did some quick math there. There is no neutrons in hydrogen 1, although there might be an electron orbiting around the nucleus. All right, in hydrogen 2, similarly, we know that the 2 is the number of protons plus the number of neutrons, while the 1 is the number of protons. Therefore, if you know that there's one proton, there must be one neutron, because 1 plus 1 is 2. Okay, I'm doing some quick math here again. So we know that there's one more neutron here. Let's represent this with an N, right? And again, we have an electron orbiting around, okay? Next, we have hydrogen 3, similarly. Protons plus neutrons give us the 3, and we know that we still have one proton. So if we know that there's one proton, this must be two neutrons that we have, because 1 plus 2 is 3. So again, we have two neutrons in hydrogen 3. All right. So another way to think about this is just think of the mass number, in this case hydrogen 1, hydrogen 2, and hydrogen 3. Think of the mass numbers as just the number of things in the nucleus, okay? We see in the first example, we only have one thing. So in hydrogen 1, we only have one thing in the nucleus, giving a mass number 1, and that one thing is a proton. In hydrogen 2, we have two things in the nucleus, one proton and one neutron. In hydrogen 3, we have three things in the nucleus, one proton and two neutrons. Okay, so this is what isotopes is. Everything is the same, except the neutron number, making it have different mass numbers as well. Next, we have atomic mass. Now, atomic mass, like I mentioned earlier, there's two types. The first type being the relative atomic mass. Relative atomic mass actually has a specific unit called the atomic mass unit, okay? So how you calculate this is one atomic mass unit is equal to 1/12 of the weight of carbon-12, see? And we refer to the weight of all other elements using the atomic mass unit. So technically, the weight of all elements is based on the known standard weight of carbon-12, okay? 1/12 of carbon-12 will give you this one atomic mass unit, and all other elements are based on this one atomic mass unit. You don't have to memorize it. It's usually given to you. All you have to know is understand why it's relative. It's relative to the standard that we've taken as carbon-12. Next, we have the average. This is based on isotopes, okay? So let's say we have some element X. And let's say this element X has two isotopes, okay? X1 and X2. This is just for the sake of an example. I don't think there's any element X. There might be, I'm not sure. Anyway, so if I want to find the weight of X, if I want to find the average weight of X, I have to know the abundancy of each of the isotopes, okay? So let's say how I find is I find the percentage of the isotope 1. And I multiply it with the mass number of isotope 1. Similarly, I would add this to the percentage of isotope 2, and I'd multiply this to the mass number of isotope 2. And I would divide this by 100 in order to get the average weight. This is just a formula, and what you memorizing formulas are honestly easy, but I need to understand what this formula is saying. Different isotopes are abundant at different amounts, okay? Mostly, one isotope is much more abundant than the other one. So isotope X1 could be 99% abundant. That would leave X2 to be only 1% abundant. So you would multiply this percentage to each respective mass number. So in the first, you'd multiply the percentage of isotope 1, multiply it by its mass number, add it to the percentage of isotope 2, multiply it by its mass number, and divide it by 100. It's just plugging in numbers after that. And that's how you find the average weight, or the average atomic mass of a certain element. All right, this is the end of the third subunit. It's kind of a little bit complicated, and it requires a lot of practice in order to understand how to find the atomic masses, and the isotopes, and the proton numbers, and the atomic numbers, and all that stuff. So make sure you do plenty of questions to understand the subunit very well. Stay tuned for the fourth and final subunit of this grade 9 chemistry.